Dear students, I greet you again. We are now still on module on reflective teaching in grade R, module code RTG1501. And we are doing unit 2, part 2. As I had explained during the part 1, that I've divided this recording into two so that it's not too big for us to share. But also it gives you time to go through each without feeling information overload. So we're now doing the last part of our unit 2 from the study guide. The presentation will start by recapping on the previous video, which means unit 2 part 1. And we're going to look at becoming a meaningful, oriented, reflective practitioner. Then we're going to look at the Gibbs cycle and what to do after reflection. We're going to look at another reflection cycle that is for critical thinking, Watkins and Murphy's reflection cycle. And we're going to look at the challenges of a reflective teacher, and then we conclude. I hope you are going to enjoy this presentation. Just as a recap, during Unit 2, Part 1, we looked at the learning outcomes of Unit 2, not the whole module. Then we looked at reflection and say, why do you reflect and how can we reflect? And we also look at the strategies for reflection. I think that is still fresh on your mind if you have just watched Unit 1. But if you have forgotten, look at Unit 1 and then look at Unit 2, Part 1, and then you get to this one. One of those reflection strategies is a diary that we would keep on going back to it, keeping a journal or a diary. When we talk about you becoming a meaning-oriented, reflective practitioner, we mean that you are the kind of a practitioner who engages in reflection practice. And the purpose is to focus on understanding and deriving meaning from your experiences, because reflection will be meaningless if we do not reflect on our practices and allow them to inform our teaching. It emphasizes the deeper comprehension of one's actions, thoughts, and feelings, and how these elements contribute to personal and professional growth. Remember, we are developing a reflective teacher, a teacher that's not like any other teacher who does the job for the sake of doing, but you are that kind of teacher who's going to reflect, think of your action, what you felt, and what you're thinking, so that all of this, when you put them together, they contribute towards your personal and professional growth. A reflective teacher is a lifelong teacher or practitioner, because we never stop learning. Even at my level, I'm still learning until I retire or until I even die. Now, there are a few steps that you could use towards becoming a reflective teacher, or step towards reflective teaching. The first one, you create the structure for reflection. It's not something that is incidental. It's something that you intentionally work on it. One of the steps is for you to develop a structure or build a structure for reflection. How do you do that? You build reflection into your daily planning. You don't just plan the day and leave it open, but you also leave a space or record that In your daily, in your everyday daily planning, you include reflection in it. That's intentional. You discuss your experiences and put issues on meeting agendas. If you can remember, in the unit 2, part 1, we spoke about that teacher who ended up putting the issues that she has been able to reflect on, to interview people on and to question them, that will help and get their opinions through questionnaires. She ended up putting those as part of the agenda for the staff meeting so that they can be discussed. Also, you keep notes on journal to record your reflections. It's so good when you sometimes go through your journal, even if it's a personal one, or especially if it's a personal one, because you are able to read your thoughts at that time. Sometimes you'd say, wow, this is how I was thinking. This is how I thought life was, but a lot has happened. So you see, it has contributed to your growth, and you can even be able to look back because you have journaled your journey. You are able to say, this is where I was and this is where I am now. Create the habit of reflection. Reflection doesn't just come as an incident or just come naturally. It's something that you have to create a habit of, that each day at the end of the day you are able to reflect. I remember of one parent who has always had a meeting with their children at the end of the day, but didn't leave it open because they are still young children that she was building. She would make them reflect on things that have been good for the day and thank God for them. So that's a habit of reflection, because the children were forced to think. Also do that, create the habit of reflection. Notice how you feel before you start your day. Notice how you feel when you are teaching. Notice how you feel at the end of the day. And recognize other people's emotions too, because once you start focusing on your feelings and emotions and leaving other people out, you will be missing out on some of the learnings that you can come from. But it can also be just called a downright selfish person if everything is about how you feel and emotions. So when you create those habits of reflection, always, in other words, when you create them and build them, let's say it's during your day activities, at the end, you have already, during the day when you notice what you are doing, you are giving yourself something to reflect on. And just do it. Have a positive attitude towards reflection and recognize its benefits. Remember, we are building you as what? A reflective team. We are now going to look at Ibs' cycle of reflection. It's the steps that Gibbs has put together as reflection steps, meaning that these are the steps that you have to take when you reflect. The first one is description. Describe the situation without bringing in your judgment or your feelings at this stage. You just describe the situation as it is. What has happened? Then you write that down. Then the second one, you think of the feelings. How did you feel? Remember when we just discussed from the previous slide that it's important to take note of your feelings. The feelings you have in the morning, the feelings you have when you start teaching, and the feelings at the end of the day. Then you do an evaluation according to Gibbs. I'll unpack them in the next slide. Then you analyze, you look at what has taken place and analyze it and say, could I have done things differently? What has happened and how did it play out? Can I do things differently? Then you get to conclusion. From there, we come with an action plan. How am I going to handle or tackle this situation or situations that are almost like this? These are reflective steps that have been created by Gibbs, and it's called, as a theorist, it's called a Gibbs reflective cycle. You describe, you look at feelings, you evaluate, you analyze, you conclude, and you take action. We are still on Gibbs cycle. As I said, this one will sort of have more explanation. I'll take you through this, but in your study guide, each step has questions that you need to ask yourself. Here we are just summarizing. The first step is description. You describe what has happened. You ask yourself what happened in the situation that you find yourself in as you reflect. And then the next one, you look at feelings. In your study guide, it says you must take note not only in of what you feel at that time, but during the day. What did you feel in the morning? How did you feel when you were teaching? How did you feel at the end? Or if it's one incident, it's about how did I feel? What was I thinking and feeling during that situation? Think of that teacher who dealt with a parent who just stomped into the classroom and started searching for her child's raincoat in a lost and found box, and also went further to look amongst other learners hung raincoats. You should ask yourself, what was my thinking, or what were my thoughts about this, and how did I feel? The next one is evaluation. What was good and bad about the experience? Remember, it's not about negative experiences only. You also reflect about good experiences. So it can either be a good or a bad experience. Then we evaluate that. What was good about it and what was bad about it? Or if it was only good, and we just say, what was good about it? What made it good? Then the next one, which is the step four, according to Gibbs cycle, is analysis. What sense can you make of the situation? You are now truly analyzing. And then the next step is step number five, is conclusion. What else could you have done? In other words, you might have taken an action or not taken an action, because not taking an action is also a reaction to a situation. So you might ask yourself, what else could I have done? And then the last one, which is step six, is action plan. If it arose again, what would you do? We know that it's very rare that situations can repeat themselves, but the reflection that you do after an action can still be applied to another situation. Or it, because reflection in a situation is about your growth. It will bring some growth for you to do something that would be better rather than to experience it as a first. So it's no longer a first because you do have a situation that you reflected on that you can apply, even if it's applied to some aspects of your situation or this. Here is now an important question. What do I do after reflection? We have been talking about reflection. Yes, you have reflected. You have applied some of the advice that you got from the various theorists. Now, what do you do after that? Reflection is about evaluation of experiences to gain new insight that informs your teaching. It would not be necessary for you to reflect if that reflection is not going to be applied. Now, you reflect so that what you have experienced and how you came to conclusion when you evaluate that experience forms or informs your teaching. We are doing this to equip you to be a reflective practitioner or teacher. But we must remember that reflection is not a linear process. We did, yes, use some steps that you can apply in your reflection, but it doesn't mean that it will be as neat as it comes. So you start by describing and this and this. No, this is just a way of equipping you with the steps that you can follow when you reflect, but it doesn't always come in that neat step-by-step way. There are many factors that affect the outcome of every situation or even the reflection itself. Then we need to delve a little bit on simplistic reflection versus critical reflection. In your book, it's well explained, but I'll just summarize it by this. When you talk about a simplistic reflection, it's a reflection that doesn't get deeper. It's just on the surface. For instance, you were organizing an event and it went well. You just said, it went very well, and you leave it there. But when you apply critical thinking to it, you get deeper. You look at what had happened, and then you analyze it, you reflect, you look at different perspectives that might have contributed to it. Also in the negative, when you think about things that did not go well, you should be able to look at it and then critically reflect by analyzing, reflecting, and questioning. Also in your everyday teaching, a teacher can look at a learner who's not able to perform at the expected developmental stage. You might look at a learner who's struggling to communicate. On a surface, you can say, this child is just lazy, or this child might not be matured enough for this grade. But when you do critical thinking, you look at various aspects. You even look at the environment where the child comes from. For instance, maybe a child comes from a community or a family that can be classified as a low socioeconomic income family or a poor family, just to put it simple. When you see a child in the morning not being able to respond, even if you don't know the child very, very much, but as a critical thinker, you look at various perspectives that might impact what you see. Is it maybe the child has not had anything to eat? May it be something that is laying heavy on the child from the family? Maybe the family has no money to pay rent, they are kicking them out, you don't know. But you look at various aspects and deeper. That's a critical thinker. I'm going to now talk about Atkin and Murphy, who are theorists. They looked at a different cycle also of reflection. The first thing is awareness of uncomfortable feeling and thoughts. Remember, you have these different theories that you can choose from. you might, as you reflect, you might become aware of an uncomfortable feeling and thoughts, recognizing and acknowledging any discomfort, confusion, and unsettling feeling and thoughts arising from an experience or situation. And when you align this to Gibbs, that's where you are at the second stage of feelings. So when you find yourself in a situation or an experience of a situation, you are able to become aware and think of, what is that feeling that I had? Was it a feeling of discomfort, confusion, or was just an unsettling feeling, which would be more like your sixth sense? And then the second thing is description of the situation. It's more like vice versa from Gibbs' cycle. Here you describe the situation objectively, including relevant details, thoughts, and feelings, and events. When you say objectively, is that you stay clear of bringing in your judgment of it. You just describe it as objective as it is. The third thing is critical analysis. Here you critically analyze the situation by identifying and challenging assumptions. I talked about having a learner who's not participating at the developmental stage, or what you think is the developmental stage. Your assumption might be that this child is just not ready for the class or for the grade that they are in. That's an assumption. But when you do critical analysis, that's where you analyze the situation and identify and look at the assumptions that are there, and you challenge them. You explore also alternatives and draw upon relevant knowledge and perspectives. The fourth thing is evaluation of knowledge. Here the practitioner evaluate the relevance and completeness of their knowledge used in the analysis. Maybe you are falling short in one way or another, where you need to take a step to be informed better. You assess how your knowledge helps explain or resolve the situation and identify gaps. You might not even be fully equipped. It's your duty to research further or ask others. Five, your identification of learning. Here the practitioner, which is yourself, you identify any new learning, insights, or understanding gained through the reflective process, and consider how this knowledge can be applied for future situations. I think I referred to that before. Now, challenges of reflective practice and becoming a reflective teacher. Are there any challenges for a person who's really willing to become a reflective teacher or reflective practitioner? Yes, there are. Those challenges can either be at personal or contextual level. Personal is in you, contextual is on the context. So contextual challenges have been nicely unpacked in your study guide, and I advise you to go look at them. Here we're talking about things like economic challenges. For instance, economic challenges that might be faced by learners from poorer families that are still young, from 0 to 9. Maybe others, they've never even been able to be exposed to a preparatory classes like grade R. That is a context. So another one might be multicultural and multilingual learners. I don't 100% agree with some of these contextual issues, because in your book it says where learners are coming from environments such as in South Africa, where they are being taught by a language that's not their home language, We know that we have a policy in South Africa for learners from grade R to grade 3 to be taught in their home language. Unless in situations where parents perhaps take learners to a school that does not offer their home language. That's a different context. But most of the learners that are at that age in South Africa are taught from a school that that teaches their home language. That's a policy. Personal challenges might be attitudes resulting from inner voices. You might be hard on yourself and have some negative self-talk about what you have done, or not forgiving yourself for a mistake that you made. It's very important as a reflective teacher to be able to reflect and consciously release yourself from any guilt. If it means you must forgive yourself, do that, but don't have negative self-talk that will be a barrier to becoming a reflective teacher. Or external voices, which in other words, you might take other people's criticisms or judgments and then allow them to affect you as a reflective practitioner or on your journey of becoming a reflective practitioner. Read more about this in your study guide. In conclusion, reflecting on our teaching practice is essential for continuous growth and improvement as early childhood educators. By taking the time to pause, analyze our experiences and identify areas for development, we can enhance our ability to create nurturing and enriching learning environments for our young learners or students. I hope this is just as straightforward as it is. When we pause, we just take the responsibilities of becoming lifelong learners. I did this thank you in many languages on purpose, just to remind you that I've created a glossary of terms where I've asked you to use your language to translate those terms that are very critical for this module. So I was just doing that now on purpose. Like in Sesotho, I'm saying ke a leboga, and then in Venda, ndiyani tambama, and then in Zulu, isiZulu ngiyabonga kakhulu, in Sepedi ke a leboga, the others are repeated. In Xitsonga, ndakhensa, and then you can add any other languages. We have got 11 languages in South Africa. I'm encouraging you to go look at the glossary of terms and have fun in translating those terms. Thank you very much. I hope this has been helpful. Then I expect to see you in a meeting that I've set and invited you to be part of on Wednesday, the 19th of June. Thank you.